Okay, good to have you in our service here on this Sunday morning, and we're going to tell you it's going to be a little bit different here, but we want to go over something that probably, oh, we do once a year or something like that, and that is, you have somebody in your home, how do you lead that person to the Lord Jesus Christ? What do you do? What's the best procedure that will, I would say, almost always produce great results if you use it? And I want to show you that procedure this morning because you can try it, you can practice it. If you have a husband, you got a wife, you got a friend or something, just practice it with them, or practice it by yourself and pretend that they're there, and to do that. But we're going to do that, so I'm going to need a volunteer, somebody that would like to, and we're going to pretend that you've been asked, and the first thing you want to do, if it's one of your friends are there, you've got to ask them a very simple question. And that is, well, if you were to die, do you know for sure you're going to heaven when you die? You know, it's a general question we ask people. If their response is, well, I hope so. Well, your next response is, you know what? We might be able to change that, and I know that we will, from a hope so to an absolutely full assurance of no so. Now, if I can show you a verse in the Bible where you can see for yourself one verse, then would you believe it? Usually you'll get, well, yes, we'll do that. Then the next thing that you want to remember, we just inject this. You want to use one verse. You may know 50 verses. Forget it. If you can get a lost person to understand one verse in the Bible that tells you how to go to heaven, you have accomplished a wonderful, wonderful thing. There are people that know John 3:16. God loved the world, gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And they can quote it. They've learned it in Sunday school, but do not really have been taught what that really means. So, you're going to show them what that really means by a procedure that we're going to show you. So, who'd like to volunteer and come up? Okay, Sharon, here you go. That's great. Now, we're pretending there's a table here
for you.
Hi, Sharon, how you doing?
Oh, you're doing great. Yeah, surgery.
Yeah, I did. Hey, let me shoot you something, Sharon, because I know you're ready to go. But before you go, let me ask you a question, okay? Hypothetically, Sharon, if you were to die tomorrow, do you know absolutely for sure you're going to heaven?
So I go to church.
Okay, that's good. And it's good to go to church. But, other words, you think so would also lead to, I hope so, you know, and that. But if I can show you, if you got a minute before you go, if I can show you in the Bible how you can absolutely know that for sure, where it says you can know you're going to heaven, and that, I'd like to do that if you got a minute. Have you got a second?
Well,
I can do that.
I'm kind of in a hurry,
but... Yeah, well, it's all right. It won't take long, you know. You can unhurry. You've been in hurries before, haven't you, honey?
Yeah, but
okay.
No,
well, I don't care about that, really. But let's go over here to John chapter 3, verse 6. If you went to church, you should know John's in the Bible.
Oh, yeah. I am the way and the truth.
No, that's John 14. Now, we're going to John 3, honey. That's what we're going to, okay? Now, what I'd like for you to do, since we're in John chapter 3 here, and your Bible's out in the car, and I happen to have mine here.
No, I didn't bring it. I don't have my
Bible. We don't care about that, as long as we have a Bible.
It's at home.
We're good. Well, I'm glad it's there. Okay. You can check on it when we get there. So we're going to look here in John chapter 3 in verse 16. Now what I'd like for you to do, if you will, and this is what you do, I want you just to read the first line for me.
The first line?
Yeah, you got to look at it in John chapter 3 verse 16.
Oh.
You know, that's where it's at. Just read me the first line.
The first line.
Yeah.
For God so loved the world.
Stop. Right there. Okay. Now it says God loved the world. Does that include you?
Yeah.
Yeah, would include me too.
Everybody.
Does it leave anybody out?
No.
Okay, so he loved the world. So if he loved the world, he had to do something about it, right?
Yeah.
Okay, would you read me the next line there?
Let's see here, that's John. That he gave his only begotten Son.
Stop. Okay, stop right there. Okay. So if he loved the world, that excludes him picking people to be saved, so he didn't elect you to be saved, or me, he loved the world the same, because we've all sinned. Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Now, Since he gave his only begotten son. He gave his only begotten son. We've got to concentrate on that second line there, see. He gave his only begotten son. Now, you should know who that is. That's Jesus Christ,
yes,
isn't it?
Yes, Jesus.
Okay. So in order, the thing is, our sin has to be paid for either by somebody else or I have to go to hell and do it myself. Now, God doesn't want us to do that. So he sent Jesus Christ from heaven to this earth. Now, you celebrate Christmas.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, you celebrate because Christ came from heaven to earth in order to do something. Okay, you celebrate Easter. Okay, he went to the cross. So he came from heaven to earth to take on a human body so he could go to the cross and pay for your sins and mine. See, he paid for mine. I'm grateful for that. That's why God gave his only begotten son there to do that. So we know that he came from heaven to earth so I could leave earth and go to heaven. So he paid for my sin. I don't have to do it. Because the wages of sin is death, not only physical death, but eternal death too. It's got a double application, okay? So, I'd like for you to read me the next line there, if you will. He gave his only begotten son, so he's going to come down here, he's going to the cross, he's going to pay for my sin, okay?
Okay.
Read me the next line.
That whosoever believeth in him.
Okay, stop right there. So, he gives a choice to any human being on this whole earth. Any human being, they got a choice. He doesn't make you believe. He says you have a choice. I put it in the Bible so we can't get it all screwed up. I mean, that's why you're reading it here, so that you don't have to believe me telling you something. See, it takes it out of my hands and puts it in. This is God speaking to you. I'm just showing you where it's at.
Oh,
you see, yeah. So, he says, whosoever believeth in him, right? Is there any reason that you wouldn't, now let me just throw this out to you. This here is, what's the date, 2013?
Yep.
Okay. 2013, do you know of all of the hundreds and millions and millions and millions and millions of people in this earth, there's only one man you dated the time from. Your time is dated from A.D. That's Anno Domini, the year of our Lord. Isn't that amazing? Well, they used to date time. They used to date time from all of the victories that the Romans had and what the Egyptians had and what the Pharaohs conquered. They would mark that date down. And then they would take it like from Nineveh. Nineveh had great, great big libraries over there in the Mesopotamian Valley. All kind of great big libraries, and they're still existing today. They've got them preserved and everything else. And they know the time that Nineveh existed. Now, you guys don't have to go through all that, but I've added a little bit here to it. And but knowing the time could be dated from their great events from that, since they had a starting point. Because they know when Nineveh was founded and so forth. Okay, so much for that. Is there any reason that you would not believe what God said, that he loved you? He sent Jesus Christ from heaven to come down here, take on a human body. That's Christmas.
Yeah.
And go to the cross. That's Easter. Sure. And pay for your sins. And then let's read the next line. Is there any reason you wouldn't believe that? You either do or you don't. So, you know, put horses around here.
Christmas, Christmas and Easter.
Yeah, you celebrate it. Yeah. Well, you celebrate because you believe it, don't you?
Yeah,
well, that's what we're getting to here. We are expounding on what you believe so that you understand what you believe instead of just believing what you don't know what you believe and think you believe what you don't believe. Okay, so we're back to the starting point here. It's true. Do you believe that he died on the cross for you?
Yeah.
Now we're ready for the next verse. Well, read it. Go ahead. Quit talking and read the next verse.
I'm trying to think of what you're telling me all this.
Yeah, well, it'll come back.
Okay, well, where was I? Should not perish.
Okay, hold it. If you believe that he died on that cross to pay for your sins so you don't have to go to hell and do it yourself, he made you two promises. Read that one again. That's the first promise he made you. Whosoever believeth in him, what?
Should not perish.
Perish, okay? Another terminology for hell. You're not going to perish in hell. You're not going to be separated. But then he tells you the positive. What do you have? Read me the next verse.
But have everlasting life.
Isn't that wonderful? Now, everlasting life is being with the Lord for all time and eternity in heaven. That's right. Now that being true, and you believe just like I do that he died for me, because our whole time's dated. Every time you sign a date, you attest to me. He's telling you, look, I'm here. Look, put your thinking cap on. I came down here. Our whole time's dated from it. You know, let's start thinking about what we need to think about. Okay? So you believe that. You'll never perish, you have everlasting life. The very next thing you want to do is come back and say, all right, now I want to shoot you this question again. You tell me, according to the Bible, where are you going to go when you leave this earth positively, absolutely? Is God telling you the truth, or is he lying to you that you will never perish but have everlasting life? Where are you going to go when you die? Tell me.
Well, according to this, and I believe in Christmas and Easter, and I believe that he died for me on the
cross.
That's
what it represents.
And I would say that if I believe that, I'm going to go to heaven.
Absolutely.
But I have to be baptized.
Well, it doesn't say that. I mean, why are you adding to it? You went to the wrong church and told you that. It doesn't say that there, does it?
Oh, it doesn't. Oh,
it doesn't say that there.
No.
Okay.
I still don't have to.
Now, you said that you think you're going to heaven.
But I am not. Because
absolutely.
I believe in Christmas and Easter.
But you believe what Christmas represents.
Yes,
he came down,
yes,
took on
Jesus
a human body.
Yes,
Easter, he went to the cross.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, I want to show you one that you want to memorize. And it's found in 1 John chapter 5 and verse 13. Well, you'll see. Just hold your shirt on here a minute. I got to get back here, 1 John. Well, this is a verse you want to memorize now. Because memory says, you use very limited verses. If you can get her to understand John 3:16, you have accomplished something that most churches don't know. Don't know how to use it. Don't emphasize it. Don't teach it so that you have to think about each verse you read. That's what I want you to do. God loved the world. We thought about it excludes nobody. So, if somebody says, well, God chose you, and he gave you the faith to believe in, that's a lie out of hell. No, God loved the world. He doesn't pick people. That whosoever includes everybody, anybody, all they have to do is believe, don't they? Okay. Now, 1 John here, we get to 1 John. There's a couple of Johns in here. There's all kinds of Johns in here. But we're going to get 1 John chapter 5. We got it. I'd like for you to read here, 11, 12, in verse 13. Would you read verse 13 for me? Because verse 13 is going to change, I think so, I hope so, into, I know so, read it to me.
Okay. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that.
Okay, what's that word, know? Is that think or know?
That ye may know. May know.
Underline that in your Bible, will you?
Okay.
So no, I'm telling you, you got your Bible at home, right?
Yes.
Okay,
somewhere.
When you get there, put a mark under it. Say that's an important word. It's know instead of think or hope so. It's a know so.
Must know.
Yeah, God doesn't tell you something to wonder if he's telling you the truth or not. When he tells you something, all he says, believe it. I'm not lying, let God be true and every man a liar. He's telling you, he wants you to know you're going to heaven. And it just throws him to pieces. Okay, that's it, good. Okay, now we're going to stop right there. But that gives you an idea. Now I know I talked about some other things about Nineveh and stuff like that. You'll have to add that in. But you can just limit it to the fact our whole time is dated from Jesus Christ. Of all of them, not Socrates, not Plato, not Philo, not all the great philosophers. They're nothing. They're dead. They died. All their writings, who cares about them? You're either in heaven or hell. Don't give me these philosophers. Don't give me Aristotle and all these guys. They're nothing. That's humanistic philosophy. Just like you get the humanistic philosophy of trash in churches that are going to tell you, well, you've got to be baptized. You've got to let Jesus come into your heart. We don't use any of that. We use the Bible that God loved the world. You understand that. Gave his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. You understand that, don't you? Yeah. That whosoever, it's anybody's choice, right? And whosoever believeth in him, he wants you to believe what he wrote to you. And that's why he put it in the Bible, so he don't have to stop around on Friday night and visit you to make sure you're home and then tell you what you want to know. When you got a Bible, all you got to do is buy it and open it up and read it, and you'll know what he wants you to know, right? And that's why he says, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman, need not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. He wants you to read the Bible. But anyway, we're getting back to this here. Okay, Sharon, tell me, now I'm going to ask you one more time. Tell me, if you were to die tonight, where are you going to go now, absolutely, positively, with no doubts, where are you going to go when you leave this earth according to the Bible?
Heaven.
Isn't that wonderful?
Yeah, because I believe in Christmas and Easter that he was born and he died in that cross.
Sure. So Christmas and Easter, when we brought that out, is to make you think and to put it in your mind, to get stirred up, what Christmas really represents. And it's more than him just coming on taking a human body. It is so he can go to the cross. So the reason we ask those questions and you read the verses, number one, you're reading it from the Bible, which has 10 times more power than me just telling you. They read it. And when they open that Bible and read it, boy, that Holy Spirit just is, this is true. So it gives the Holy Spirit a chance to work other than me just talking to you. That's important. So anytime I can get somebody that comes to my house. Now, we did this with the people, remember when we sold the pickup with the plow on it and so forth like that? That we had church had. Well, the ones that run the wrecking yard out to Ballinton out there, she came in. And it was, we were signing the title over and so forth like that, letter to the Lord. Starts Luther. And never heard anything like that. But then, on that weekend, they were going to go to church that weekend. They had to go back out to South Dakota where all her relatives are to visit. Now, when she told the relatives about that, oh, stay away from that church. Stay away from that church. That's not right. You got to be baptized then. So you got somebody right on the offense. That's Satan trying to get you. There are two people after you. Remember we say in him, it's going to destroy your life, going to ruin your testimony, going to lie to you, because in John 8:44, the Bible tells us that Satan is a murderer and a liar. Now, going to that particular Lutheran church, then anybody that contradicts that, Luther is their God, 100%. And you don't buck that, because you're a cult if you buck that. But if you believe it, you're going to be in hell with Martin Luther. Martin Luther was never a saved man. Never. Baptism saves you. Baptism makes you a child of God. Right in the catechism. Read it. Most Lutherans have no idea what the catechism says because they just go there and listen to the preacher and whatever he says. And then he'll have them stand up and say, I'm an ordained minister of God and I am and have the power to forgive your sins. Or words to that effect. And then he's going to forgive all of your sins and all in favor say amen. So we got a bunch of people out there don't know beans from apple butter saying amen to something that isn't true. Because the preacher said it. Show that to me in the Bible. And they pray on that. Because you get down around Tennessee, we have some friends in Tennessee, might be up here in a month or two, or they want to come up and visit when we get really recuperated, you know, and so forth. And I said, how many Lutheran churches do you have down there? I don't even know we got any. Certain parts of the country are saturated, and they want you. They want your money, they want your person, they love to have the biggest church and so forth like that. And evidence is, you're sitting in a little pothole of Walnut Grove, Minnesota. Now I'm not saying that negatively as far as that. This is a little town of 600 people. You have two absolutely satanic churches that ordain homosexual preachers in this one little tiny town. Do you think Satan wants to give that up easily? I don't think he does, brother, at all. But to get you to think about that, there's a battle going on. And that battle is, you go to heaven one way. That's the only way. Christ said in John 14:6, I am the way. That's the truth. It's not a lie. And no man comes to God in heaven except through Jesus Christ, not water baptism. And in order to foul you up, Martin Luther quotes in Peter, you'll never find where Peter or John or the Apostle Paul said water baptism takes you to heaven. You will never find in the Bible where anybody was ever baptized until after they trusted Jesus Christ as their Savior. You will never find in the Bible where a baby is ever to be baptized. And when you have your baby baptized, you have put him one step on the way to hell when he grows up. Why is that? The reason is, and I'll give you the one example that stands out because I'll never forget this one. I'm going down the street in Ohio, and I'm just knocking on doors. I'm just passing out tracts, inviting somebody to church, and so forth. So this guy was out in the front yard there, working in the yard there, and I stopped, and I said, sir, I said, I'd just like to invite you to visit on Sunday. But I said, let me shoot you a question. I said, if you were to die tonight, do you know for sure you're going to heaven when you die? Absolutely, I do, he said. And I said, well, that's great. How are you going? And he said, my mother had me baptized when I was 6 or 7 months old, and I have my certificate to prove it, and my mother is the greatest mother that anybody could ever have, and I'm going to heaven because she did what God wanted her to do, and she baptized me, and the most precious thing I have in my life, knowing I'm going to heaven, is my baptismal certificate. This guy's lost on his way to hell big time. That's what you run into because a mother, and she could have been the finest mother there ever was. I mean, and now I've got to figure out something to tell him that isn't true. And I did, and got ordered off of his property. That's what you run into when you do something by a false church, a cult church, that tells you something that is a lie, and you listen to the preacher without looking in the Bible. Now, in Peter, when he talked about, and this is Martin Luther's favorite one, as it is with every preacher, I should say Lutheran preacher or Catholic or whatever you want, doesn't make any difference. Baptism doeth also now save us. Boy, that sort of nails it down, doesn't it? If you're baptized, you're saved, right? Well, that's about 8 or 9 words, but there's about 25 or 26 other words to the verse. That's the problem. Now, if you got your Bible, let's go over here to Peter, and let's see what Peter says, all right? Okay, Sharon, you can go on back. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
You did a great job. Where are you going to go when you die, Sharon?
Oh, I was
going
to go to the liquor store.
Yeah, well, that's great. Well, I'll tell you, you've got a personality, you'll be there tomorrow.
But I'm going to go to heaven now, though, Pastor.
Oh, I loved it. I loved it. That's great, Kathy. Or not Kathy, or Sharon. If I'm there. You had me so shook up, I couldn't even remember who's doing what here. Well, I'll tell you what, this is the natural church service, but we're sure having a little... I'm having fun. I don't know about you. You have a little bit of fun here. Yeah, well, that's it. Okay, let me get this verse over here. Get the right one here. Well, my glasses are fogged up. I got bifocals on. I can't see beans from apple butter. Oh, let me see here. Okay, let's look over here in 1 Peter chapter 3. And let's look here in verse 21. Okay? In verse 21. So we're going to read the first line here together. Okay? And it says this. The like figure whereunto even baptism doeth also now save us. Now I want to stop there and count how many words that is. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 words. Right? Now, I happen to look and there's more to this verse than just those first 11 words. So we got to see if the rest of the verse explains what the first part of the verse is saying. This is the point of listening to the preacher, you get your Bible out and start reading it. Okay? So here we go. Not the putting away of the filth of the flesh. Other words, baptism does not save us for eternal life by putting away the filth of the flesh. The filth of the flesh is the fact that we have all sinned and come short of the glory of God. Romans 3:23. So it doesn't do that. It doesn't save us. But it's an answer of a good conscience toward God by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So What is this verse saying? It says, the like figure wherein to baptism doth also now save us from what? A guilty conscience by not following him in believers' baptism after we are saved. That's what it's speaking about, because God wants a Christian to be baptized. Only a Christian is to be baptized. You're not baptized to become a Christian. This is instructions of Peter that after you're a Christian, he wants you to be baptized as a testimony. Along with this, what Paul said in the book of Romans, chapter 1 and verse 16, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, whether you're a Jew or whether you're a Gentile. It doesn't make any difference. Jew, Gentile, no difference. You're a human being. I'm not ashamed of what Jesus Christ did for me. So, wanting us to be baptized as a testimony. That's why, if you're in a good Bible-teaching church, your baptism is not sprinkling. That has nothing to do to show the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. You are to be buried with him in the likeness of his death. You are to be submerged underwater, which shows death. So, when that pastor places you under the water, you are publicly saying, I believe that Jesus Christ died for me, and I'm showing this to you publicly because I'm not ashamed of the gospel that I believe. I'm not ashamed that Jesus Christ gave his life, went to that cross, and was buried by paying for my sins. Then when you're raised out of the water, it shows resurrection. Therefore, I believe that Jesus Christ was resurrected and God accepted his payment, and if all sins were not paid, he would still be in the grave. But since he paid for all sins, and the payment was made because he was sinless, then I am baptized, raised in the likeness of his death, or likeness of his resurrection, because he paid for my sins. You see how simple that is. And you're not ashamed to publicly show that by an outward act of water baptism, because you want people to know that that represents your faith is in the death and the burial of Jesus Christ. You're placed under the water showing death, you're raised out of the water showing resurrection, and you're not ashamed to do that because you want people to know that Jesus Christ is your Savior. I don't know how much more simple that could be. You give it to the pastors, you get it into a church, you get into a cult leader like Luther and some of these others and Jehovah's Witnesses and everything else, and you got a bunch of garbage, a whole sack full of garbage that should be in a trash can somewhere, because it'll lead you right straight to hell, trying to say that because you do something, and water baptism is a work you do out of the flesh. Not by works of righteousness which we do, but according to his mercy has he saved us, right? For by grace are we saved through faith, not of ourselves. It's a gift to God, not of works. At least you'd only brag about it. And how many of you go, oh, I've been baptized just like that man I talked to in the front yard there, on there. And he was so incensed because mommy did something. She was deceived by the preacher, deceived by the church. And therefore, his whole trust was in what his mother did for him. And give him that certificate, that was the prize of his life. Now, for me to try to lead him to the Lord, Mom, what you did was you sealed your son right straight into hell, because when I give him the truth, the first thing I got was, get off of my property. Now, do you understand why it's important for a mother to have the right answer for salvation? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. There's no other name under heaven given by man whereby we must be saved. You go to Acts 13, 38, 39. Be it known unto you, therefore, men and brethren, that through this man is preached unto you the forgiveness of sins, and all that believe are justified from all things from which you could not be justified by the law of Moses. So we get the Bible, we'll get the preacher out of there blown off, he don't know what he's talking about, because he's got to preach, because that's what the Lutheran College told him what to preach. And to do that, I wonder, here we got two homosexual churches in town here. You go to the church, you're going to invite somebody to church, you're going to lead them to believe that, first of all, women preachers are women preachers. Every woman preacher that ever told you that God led her to preach is lying. line right through your face, and you ought to tell them so. Absolutely. I wish we had preachers that had the guts and the backbone to stand up and say, you're a liar, fella. Lady, God never called you. Show me the verse in there. You're not to teach men. He wrote that to Timothy. If a man desire the office of a bishop, a man, not a woman. We don't have any of the 12 apostles who are women, do we? Are there? But I'll tell you what, their wives are important. You are not degraded because God, there has to be a leader. There's a leader in manufacturing companies. There's a leader in the car companies. There's a leader in businesses and so forth. There has to be a leader. God chose the men to be the leaders when it comes to in the home and so forth. And the woman is to be the helpmate. And what a privilege you have as a woman to do and to follow what God told you to do, to back up your husband, serving the Lord and so forth, to back up if you're a pastor's wife. And I'm saying this, I think I got one of the greatest. Truthfully. And what she does, I can't hardly believe sometimes, you know. But the wife is to back up the husband. If you don't have a husband, a leader, you got a problem in your home. You got a big problem in your home. And that husband should be the leader and so forth. But it's your job to help him. It's your job to lead people to the Lord, just like he's supposed to lead people to the Lord and so forth. And what a wonderful union that is. What a thrill it is to have somebody trust the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. We just took one little aspect here. But it will at least give you, use the Christmas. Use the verse to God love the world. Okay, you explain to me. Okay, that makes you think about what that verse says, doesn't it? Absolutely. If he loves the world, does that exclude anybody? And you throw in a little thing. Well, he didn't choose you to go to heaven. And not choose you, as these Pentecostals say, that's a damnable satanic doctrine. In other words, I predestined you and needed you to be saved, really. I think my Bible said God loved the world. And he gave the Lord Jesus Christ to pay for the sins of the world. And whosoever the world can do that can be saved. And here you bunch of cult religions are out here saying, oh, God chose me. I love those guys. I got 2 minutes yet. Margie was working when we were down in Painesville, Ohio, and she was working for a company down there. And anyway, here comes this Tutti Frutti on the elevator. Oh, we're just praising Jesus this morning, praising Jesus. All this phony baloney of these Pentecostals have put out. And Margie said, boy, I'll tell you, people are just turned off at this. And I said, I'll tell you what, Margie. I love to take him out to dinner. She set it up, and I took him out for dinner. I thought, man, it's going to be fun. Here you are, you self-righteous hypocrite. You're putting on this, oh, how much you love Jesus. You know what? Lead him to the Lord. That'll show you how much you love Jesus, amen? I don't have to go around here putting, oh, this is it. The only reason I relate things to you folks here is you can do it. That's it. You have no fear of anybody, no matter what education they have or anything else. You have absolutely no fear of anybody because you have the truth. And if they don't like it, too bad, get out of here. That's too bad. I'll pray for you. But listen, you don't shame me, buddy. I know who I believe. I know whom I have believed, and I'm persuaded he's able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. Right? I know where I'm going when I die. I know where I came from. I came because God created me. I know I have a purpose in life. And God says, you know, present your body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is only our reasonable service. Be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. I know why I'm here. And not only that, I know where I come from. I know what I'm doing here. I enjoy what I'm doing here. It's a lot of fun. It thrills my heart when I can sit down with somebody and lead them to Christ. And not only that, if I didn't make it through that surgery, I know I'm going to heaven. What more in the world would a Christian want than to know what you come from, what you're doing here, and where you're going to go when you die, and use your life for the Lord Jesus Christ? How can I do this and give him my best to live for him completely after all that he's done for me? I thank him for this little thing. Open heart surgery, 3 bypasses, whoopee-doo. I feel great. Isn't this wonderful? This is the same week, folks. Am I grateful to the Lord? I'm grateful to the Lord because I know you people were praying for me. There were other people praying for me. You are precious. You're the best. And I'm going to miss a Sunday? You got to be kidding. If I'm dead, but if I'm not dead, this is where I belong because this is what God wants me to do and this is my job, just like He's got a job for you to do. There may be somebody that you know, you don't know if they're going to heaven or not. Maybe we got a rack of tracks back there. Take some home with you. Start passing them out. You can do that. Can't you do that? Or are you ashamed of what Christ did for you? Be ashamed of what He did for me? I was lost on my way to hell. At 17 years old, with a car accident, I came one hair from dying. How do you get your throat cut from here right to the jugular vein and it stops? You're telling me that's an accident? I said, dear Lord, I don't know how you did it. Did you put your finger down there and stop that glass from cutting that jugular vein? If you had, I'd die at 3 o'clock in the morning at 17 years old. I got so many things to be thankful for. I'll never get through thank you, but never. And when I get to heaven, I just want to hug the Lord Jesus Christ, and I want to hug the pastor that led me to the Lord. Thank you for coming all the way from Troy, Ohio, to Tip City, Ohio, down there, coming to my home. And I didn't want a preacher around. Knock on the door, said, I won't stay long, and I hope you keep your word. I didn't want to see a preacher. I didn't want him anything. It was short and fast. God doesn't want you to go to hell, Max. And Margie and I both trusted the Lord that night when Dr. Tom came down. And there, I'll tell you what, that was a pretty precious night. I'd probably been lost today if he hadn't done that. But I'll tell you what, I think it's wonderful. We're living at a time when America's shocked. You might as well hang it up. Thankfully, we still have some privileges that we have. But I think the greatest thing in the world is, how can I thank the Lord for everything that He's done? Son and daughter-in-law drive all the way from Sioux Falls this morning to be here and to eat dinner with us, then to go drive back. What a blessing. And here you folks are. Kathy got back safe. We ran for her. She had a nice trip. Got back safe. You pray for each other. You love each other. And so forth. We got a lot to be thankful for, folks. Do we not? Sure. I think it's great. It depends, and here's what you have. You got people that want the truth, they will come. If you don't want the truth, they'll leave. It's that simple, because this church is going to teach where you can look in the Bible, and you can see, and that's what you need to believe. I was deceived enough as a child and almost went to hell for it. That I made up my mind, and there was a man by the name of Dr. M.R.D. Hahn. He founded the Radio Bible Class over in Grand Rapids, Michigan. He was a medical doctor. I read a couple of his books, and I thought, this is the greatest preacher I ever heard. He took complicated things and just laid them out so simple. And I said, God, if you ever give me a gift, give me a gift to make the Bible easy to be understood to people. That's the greatest gift I could ever have, is to take what churches have screwed up and let's lay it out simply so you can read it and understand it. How can you not understand that God loved the world? Kathy explained it. That's everybody. Gave His only begotten Son. That's Jesus Christ. But you're thinking now, you're thinking what Christmas is doing. What did He do? He went to the cross. Your sins are paid for. Do you know everybody in hell are the dumbest people for what one reason or another they rejected the payment that God sent from heaven to earth. And He even made it. I don't know why they don't bring the Greek out in this. It's a wonderful thing to do it. You must be born again. The word again is a Greek word, anothen, and it means you got to be born from above. So if you got to be born from above, somebody from above has to come down here for you to believe in, because there's nothing you can do here below to get up there above. It's just like the kingdoms. There are five kingdoms, and not one of them can get to one above it by itself. The one above it has to reach down and bring the one up to it. And so forth. You got the mineral kingdom. You got the vegetation has to reach down, bring minerals up so it can grow. You got the animal kingdom, it has to reach down and eat the grass and everything else and do that, it's got to bring that up to it. And then you got the human kingdom, we like steaks, don't we? So, I'll tell you what, we reach down and get the cow's gild and eat that. And you know what? Then we have the heavenly kingdom, that's the fifth one. And there isn't anybody who can get to the heavenly kingdom. God had to reach down and send Jesus Christ to bring us up to it. There isn't one of those five kingdoms, the one who can get up to the one above it thyself. The one above it has to reach down and bring it up. Isn't that amazing? That's amazing to me, you know. And, hey, 10:58. Now let me say this in closing if I can, because there are others that are watching these tapes and so forth. The most important thing in your life is this. If you're watching this, do you know for sure that you are going to heaven when you die? If you don't know that for sure, I can assure you of one thing, you're all lost on your way to hell. Because the Lord said, see that Bible right here? He said, I put it in here so churches can't get it screwed up, preachers can't twist it around and reword it and leave half of a verse off like Martin Luther did, not tell you what it means. But he tells you very just simply here, I love you, I died for you, I sent Christ from heaven to earth so you could leave earth and go to heaven. He went to the hell of the cross so you don't have to go to a literal hell. What a wonderful Savior that we have, you see. And how could I do less than give him my best? Live for him completely, the best I can. I'm not perfect, I never will be. I'm going to blooper, make a blooper. You're going to make a blooper. Live with it, get over it, go on, you know. But we're going to try to do the best we can because we want to see people go to heaven, whether it's our relatives, our neighbor, or anybody else, right? And I'm not ashamed to tell them of what Christ did for me, so you can do the same for them. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God, and that's your responsibility. God uses people to win people to Him. And if you're a Christian, that's our responsibility. So, if you're watching these and you've never trusted Jesus Christ, we're going to bow in a word of prayer. And when we do, you just mentally tell the Lord, thank you, dear Lord, for paying for my sins. I didn't know it was that simple. And all I have to do is the home's bought and paid for. Yep. Yep, bought and paid for. It's a free gift. Yep, it's a free gift. It sure is. We're saved by grace through faith. The home's bought. The title deed is there. It's yours. I'm offering it to you. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved from hell. You don't have to go to hell and pay for your sins. It's all that the home's bought for. It's a free gift. Will you please take it? And if you've never trusted Christ as your Savior, why don't you just accept that free gift and thank the Lord? Thank you for paying for my sins, dear Lord. Nobody ever loved me like you. You know, wonderful. Let's just bow over to prayer, okay? Dear Lord, we thank you so much. I thank you for the folks that we have today that come today. And I hope, dear Lord, some of these things will help a little bit in our responsibility. And the fact is, always show them the Bible. Have them take it verse by verse by verse by verse and line. And we thank you for that and the privilege. And we just ask you, especially for each and every one, the ones that have the tapes. And we thank you for all you do in Jesus' precious name. Amen.